Joining us today is Tom Carr from Northern Michigan. He is an independent writer and journalist who spent 25 years in daily newspapers, primarily the Traverse City Record Eagle. As a freelancer, he branched out into other media and has reported and produced many stories for Interlaken Public Library and had his work broadcast on NPR and Michigan Radio as well. His work has appeared in the Detroit Free Press, the New York Daily News, TraversTicker.com, Travers Magazine, and others. He has won journalistic awards in investigative reporting, feature writing, breaking news, and for writing a humor column. Today, Tom will share stories from his book, Blood on the Mitten, Infamous Michigan Murders, 1700s to Present. Please welcome Tom Carr.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for coming. Thank you, Jane. It's all going to be a little bit warmer out there, and happy St. Patrick's Day to everybody. I do have some green in my shirt, I don't even know. I don't have a lot of green things that don't say Michigan State University on, so I wanted to class it up a little bit. And I appreciate your interest in Blood on the Mitten. And can the people in the back hear me okay? Excellent, okay. And it was a fascinating book to write, and I hope that it's an interesting book for you to read as well. Cases in it range over about 250 years, starting back in the late 1700s, early 1800s, when there was a bit of a situation that was very similar to what happened 100 years earlier in Salem, Massachusetts, but this time it was on Mackinac Island. And there was, Mackinac Island was at a strategic post in the Straits, as much of you know, or just a little bit to the east of the Straits. And it had a lot of traffic with trappers and merchant seamen of all sorts, fishing boats, plus soldiers, and alternately British and American soldiers stationed there. Now, there came a point where the women of the evening were, people thought that they were obviously corrupting these fine upstanding trappers. And so something had to be done, and so they had with accusations of being witches, similar to in Massachusetts, like they said 100 years prior to that. Seven women lost their lives because for an example, they would chain them up, toss them over a deep part of the, the side of the island where it was particularly deep, and if they rose to the top, they were a witch. So it was truly a no-win situation. how I came to write this book, I got to say also, it comes all the way to 2016, which is when this edition was put out. And the most recent case was one that you probably heard up in the news or remember from the news last year, which was the Uber driver shooter in Kalamazoo. And I chose that because it was kind of a sign of the times. One of the things that is the kind of murders that we see that perhaps we didn't see in other eras are the random shootings. Plus, it's indicative of the economy, the sharing economy, with being an Uber driver and such. So I decided to, that one happened just shortly before the book came out, and so I included that one as well. But throughout the history of Michigan, these the cases in here include crimes of passion, of greed, of desperation, and of insanity. Among other things, there are poisonings, bombings, beheadings, and other crimes that, a lot of them I had not known until I started researching this. Now, how I came to write it was that I have some good friends who have been in the publishing industry and whom I've worked with in the newspaper industry as well, and two women up in Traverse City who have a tremendous amount of publishing industry experience, teamed up with a third gentleman from Kansas City who came up, where he was in charge of the publications for the Kansas City Star, and they started Mission Point Press, and they called me, and I was very, very flattered, very, very honored to have them ask me to write something for them. Since I'd known them professionally, and we kind of hashed out what it would be, and I am interested in history, I'm interested in music now, I don't want that. I'm interested in, you know, but true crime, and so we kind of decided to mix the true crime and the history together, and make it about Michigan, its times and its geography, and some of the worst people that have ever come through here. So, then we had to decide what we were going to include, and there's 57 cases in here. And the first case in the book is kind of needs to be in here because it is so historic, because it had a very historic impact, and that was the case of Stephen Gifford Simmons. Now, Stephen Gifford Simmons was known to be a very charming guy when he wasn't drunk, and he owned an inn that was on Michigan Avenue in what is now the city of Wayne, and it's just outside of Detroit to the west a little ways, and then it's also the main thoroughfare from Detroit to Chicago for many years, and it plays greatly into Michigan's history. But also it was at that time seeing a whole lot of settlers coming from Ohio or upstate New York or Pennsylvania and settling into moving out further west as the frontier was moving out into Michigan. And so in 1830, there was pretty much a mud track, and it was, Stephen Gifford Simmons had an inn along there with his wife. Now he got too drunk one night, and there are different versions of the story, and some of it has become part of legend, but the upshot was that he beat his wife and she died tragically. Now it was sadly a domestic case which we would refer to it these days as all too common. However, it became historic in that Stephen Gifford Simmons was sentenced to hang, and he was hung in what is right, very close to downtown Detroit at Gratiot and Farmer, and a spot that looks like, I'm jumping myself. This is a little bit of a look at the book. This is the first chapter in it. Anyway, the execution was a big event, and so I'm going to read a chapter out of the book that kind of shows you just how big this was. As the day approached, and at the time, Detroit had a population of like 2,000. Now, not everybody in the city wanted to come and see it, but there were about 2,000 people who showed up. But a lot of people came rode for days to come here. And for this event, as the day approached, grandstands went up in a triangle of land north of Jefferson Avenue. People rode a day's journey to see the show. They camped out, cooked food, sang and played songs while waiting for the big event. In fact, the hanging of Stephen Gifford Simmons may have been the largest gathering to date in the not yet Motor City. The sheriff was so keen on entertaining the death watchers that he allowed vendors to sell their wares and booked a fife and drum band. So it was quite the spectacle. But something happened when it actually came time for the main event. And there arose a legend from this that Stephen walked up to the gallows singing a hymn in a beautiful baritone voice. And this is what turned people's moods, what changed people's minds. That has later been claimed that that is not the case, that that was a myth, that that was put out there as kind of a, to romanticize the story when it was, when it became a prohibitionist tale, that they wanted to say, you know, let's get rid of booze. But nevertheless, something made people decide that watching a guy get hanged wasn't all it's cracked up to be, I suppose. Because as I also, I'll read from the end of the book, the Frontier Spectators found the display distasteful enough that in 1846, the legislature abolished the death penalty. Simmons was the last man to hang by order of the state of Michigan, and Michigan was the first government in the English-speaking world to outlaw the death penalty. Now, whether or not, you know, it still gets debated from time to time and whether or not that will remain the law. It has been since 1846, and the Stephen Gifford Simmons spectacle of the hanging is one of the things that's said to have changed that. But if you go down to Detroit today, you can't really tell. This is where it would have occurred, the corner of Gratiot and Farmer. And I notice I keep having a laser or something, but it keeps showing up. I hope it doesn't mess. I don't think it'll mess it. I don't really need it, but
okay.
I haven't figured out how to turn it off, so
oh, okay.
No big deal. But that is a branch of the Detroit Library. That's, of course, the people mover above it. And there's nothing to tell you that that happened there before. And it would be kind of interesting if they did have something there. But nevertheless, it did have a large impact. Now, there were other places that were forever changed by horrible things that happened there. And one of those that people claim has, you know, kind of ruined the whole mood of a town for generations and generations and just brought it down, I guess, is the town of Bath, Michigan. Does anybody know about Bath? And if you know about Bath, Michigan, and you're not from the Lansing area, it's probably because of what happened there on May 18th, 1927. And that was just days from when Charles Lindbergh was to take to the air to become the first person to cross the Atlantic Ocean in an airplane. Well, at 8:45 a.m. in the morning of an ordinary, beautiful spring school day morning, a whole side of the school collapsed in a vast explosion that was heard as far away as Lansing, which was about 10 miles to the southwest. And the person who did that, believe it or not, was a school board member, had been a school board member, and he was angry about the building of this school and the taxes that were levied, and his farm was in foreclosure, so he had some, you know, problems of his own, but people, the other farmers around there had remembered the guy as being kind of an extravagant farmer. He had showroom quality tractors. Would be immaculate when he'd be out there, you know, plowing or whatever, and he'd be wearing shined shoes. And I even know a lot of farmers and nobody who's ever, you know, dressed like that to drive a tractor. But they still thought he was, he kind of made friends because he helped a lot of people get rid of stumps on their farms with his knowledge of explosives. He also knew a lot about electricity, and so he had toiled away in the basement of the school for weeks, and people thought, oh, that's nice, he's donating his time to hook up the electrical system. What he was really doing was putting pyrotol and TNT into the nooks and crannies around the basement and hooking that up to the clock so that at 8:45 a.m.
schoolhouse,
it exploded. Now, as I said, it was heard from miles around, and before long, people came from far away as Lansing as quickly as they could back in 1927 and were helping sift through the rubble and save whoever they could and, you know, pounding up the bodies. And Andrew Kehoe, the perpetrator, came back to the scene This time, he had a vehicle laden with explosives and shrapnel, and as he was talking to the superintendent with whom he'd had a particular beef, he shot into the vehicle and sent the shrapnel flying, and with that, killed himself, the superintendent, and most sadly, a young boy who had just survived the first blast. The death toll was 45, including the killer. That makes it, still, in this day, when we think that, you know, things are, well, you know, we have seen way too many school massacres. This is still the most deadly school massacre in the history of the United States. Another town that was forever changed by something that has been called a murder, but there's really a little bit of gray area there. And are you familiar with the town of Calumet? Now that also is a beautiful town up in the Keweenaw Peninsula, which I think is maybe one of the most beautiful spots of this beautiful state. And back in 1913, it was a boom town because of the copper industry and because a lot of people, immigrants were coming like crazy, and they had several different foreign language newspapers, including plus the English language newspapers, to accommodate the people who come up to work in the booming copper mines. There was a strike in the town, and it had already run for about a half a year by Christmas Eve of 1913. And that's when the Women's Auxiliary of the Mining Union were putting on a party in the Italian Hall, which was a second story portion of a building near the downtown area. In the middle of the festivities, whether they were, doing their pageants, singing songs, whatever, handing out gifts, somebody yelled fire. There was no fire, but people ran, of course, to the nearest exit. And unfortunately, the nearest exit was a steep stairway leading to a door opening inward. And when the first ones got there, the crush of people from behind caused quite the pressure, and several people were asphyxiated. They could not breathe with the crush coming down, and some people were trampled. And in the end, there were 73 people, mostly children, who were killed. And so people spent the next day, Christmas Day, some of them, or the night beforehand, the bodies were laid out on the snow, in the snowbanks, and people came by and identified their loved ones. Now, nobody has ever been charged with the crime, and who knows if anybody expected such, devastation from something like that, because, maybe they just thought it would be fun to see a panic, spoil the party. Who knows whether, this was devised or not, but nobody ever found the person. They were, when I look at old copies of the news, one of the newspapers there talking about it, shortly thereafter, they're talking about this arch fiend who did this, somebody who was described as being a big guy, big dark beard, big long dark coat. And it almost sounds like, the kind of villain they would have seen in the silent movies they would have been watching at the time. But this tragedy was never pinned on anybody. They don't know what the motive was, but it's been widely believed that it was somebody from the mining companies who meant to cause whatever kind of havoc on this situation. Woody Guthrie wrote a song about it a few years later called The 1913 Massacre, in which he claims that it's the union, the companies that did this. But again, there's no proof of that. But I love the town of Calumet going there, because you look around there and it's you can tell there was more going on there at one time. It's got, the structures of a bigger town than what is happening there now. And it's got these beautiful old sandstone UP buildings like you see up there. But It lost, like I said, it was 33,000. It was down to several hundred, you know, in the past few years. The mining companies kind of sputtered and finally left in the late 60s, unfortunately. But up until that time, you know, it was, you know, it kept going downward. The population was steadily going down. But they believe that, you know, there was quite an exodus quite after this tragedy. A lot of people simply did not want to hang around after such a horrible event. And so some people say that that was the beginning of the end. I mean, not that it's the end. Calumet is still a town, still a lovely town. It's our National Historic Park. And I'd recommend anybody go there, but I doubt if it will ever be 33,000 people again. But that's kind of a unique case. I haven't, you know, really heard of anything else like that anywhere. But there are other crimes in this book that are a little bit more indicative of their times, in which, you know, there were the 60s to the 80s, which doing some research just about trends as I was noticing things while I was doing this, and that was the era of the serial killer. And not that they don't still exist out there, but if you remember, there was always somewhere some, you know, somebody somewhere who was, you know, where people were being disappeared or showing up dead, and, you know, it was in a methodical way that kept being recurring. Well, for some reason, the 60s through the 80s were like, this was happening. Like now, we might tend to be more likely to see the random shootings. The most famous one in Michigan was one that, you know, I experienced as a kid, not experienced, but, you know, watched in the news as a kid, and watched people around me terrified for the young women around, because I grew up about 20 miles out of Ann Arbor. And in the late 60s, there was John Norman Collins, who was a serial killer, murdering young women in Ann Arbor and Ypsilanti, two university towns, of course. And he was as I talk about in here, there's a kind of some interesting asides that I hadn't known. But in 2005, there was a case that had been put in his, you know, responsibility, that somebody looked at and said, this doesn't quite fit, because this young woman was shot. She was found fully clothed, and the others were strangled and you know, molested and such. But anyway, so somebody took some very old DNA samples and had them tested, and in 2005, Gary Leiterman was convicted of the death of Jane Mixer, which this guy, you know, it would have been great to see him being confronted with that, because he probably thought he was in the clear. He had somebody take the responsibility for this. But not that John Norman Collins has ever taken responsibility. He still claims he never did any of this. But there's a little aside. I have several sorts of things like this in here. This one is called Last Seen Alive, and it's just a sad story, and then I'll get a little bit less sad. But Karen Sue Beineman, the last time she was seen alive was heard to say she'd done two stupid things that day. She bought a wig, and she'd accepted a ride from a stranger on a motorcycle. Sure, she was a little nervous about the ride. She had the shopkeeper come out and take a look at him, but she went, not before remarking hauntingly, I've got to be either the bravest or the dumbest girl alive, because I've just accepted a ride from this guy. The shopkeeper was later able to identify John Norman Collins from police photographs. So, you know, just a heartbreaker that, you know, just for one wrong thing, this poor girl paid the ultimate price. Now, there's, I've known about that one forever, but I mean, since it happened, because I was so close to when it did, and I was like 10 years old and could not fathom this kind of thing happened. But there's another case that I found out about while I was writing this. In fact, thanks to a copy editor, I was, you know, nearing the completing the project. And he said to me, and it's like, you know, maybe you knew that, being in a city like Bay City, but there were pirates in the Great Lakes. And I really had never thought about that, but I guess there were quite a few of them. But were there any, like in Huron, over this way that I should look into? But this guy was in Lake Michigan. His name was Dan Seavey. And he's one of the most, you know, notorious of them. He lived in Escanaba, and he was, he had a schooner. And he did a lot of legitimate business. He hauled a lot of legitimate cargo throughout the Great Lakes, taking it down to Chicago or wherever. But he also did a lot of shady things. He, well, beyond shady, I mean, he dealt in illegal venison. He dealt in stolen lumber. He, you know, dealt in illegal liquor. And he knew the places to get all this, to take all this stuff down in Chicago where he could sell it on the black market. And, but if you're expecting him to look like Jack Sparrow, that's not quite. He was a lot more 20th century appearance than that. And he didn't carry a sword. But he did, however, use a cannon. I mean, what pirate story would be complete without a cannon? There was a fishing boat out on Lake Michigan that was also kind of horning in on his illegal venison trade. He warned them to back off. They didn't. He bolted a cannon onto the hull of his ship, and he shot through theirs. I mean, not the deck of the ship, and shot through their hull. And they and the entire crew drowned in that situation. So that's where, you know, one of the places in which he stepped in from being a romantic character to being a murderer. I mean, he also is said to have dealt in sex slaves among pioneer women, and some of them were kidnapped and then taken down to Chicago. There was another time when he had a jug of liquor, and he saw that there was a ship moored in Charlevoix that had some cedar logs that he thought, I could get a lot of money for those. So he took his jug of liquor on board, and he talked, you know, he just acted like a friend and pretended to drink along with everybody else. And when they got rip-roaring drunk, he set sail. And out in the middle of Lake Michigan, he put the captain in chains, tossed him overboard, and tossed the other drunken crew overboard, sailed down to Chicago, sold the logs and the boat. In fact, but later on in his life, he was the federal government was on to him. He is said to have quit his life of piracy and have worked with them on how to stop other pirates. Takes a beat to catch a beat. Pirate to catch a pirate. But that was, you know, his saga is something that would make for a fascinating movie, it seems. It's almost surprising that it hasn't been so far, but there was another case in Detroit in 1970 that was coincided with the movie, and a lot of people thought that maybe, you know, it was life imitating art or art imitating life, but it was just a pure coincidence. It was in May of 1970, and a man named Arvel Garland was upset because, well, this was the time when a lot of people were upset about their older children, young adults, getting into drugs, the sexual revolution, just protesting the war in Vietnam. It was just, there was the so-called generation gap, and some people, you know, most people just had a lot of arguments with their kids over this and such, but Arvo Garland was obsessed, so he took a couple of handguns into the commune in which his daughter was living, which was near Wayne State University in Detroit, and he saw his daughter lying there in the same room. And this was an interracial commune, so there were other people, you know, that were lying. There were people of, there were African-American friends lying around nearby, and this, none of this settlement wasn't, so he shot his daughter and the friends as they lay there. Then he went to the nearest police precinct, told them what he did, and they sent him home for the evening, for the night, until, and then took it up later. Well, right about that time, there was a show, a movie that came out, and anybody remember the movie Joe? That had, with Peter Boyle, that we remember from Young Frankenstein and Everybody Loves Raymond. Also a very young Susan Sarandon, wasn't it? This came out within a couple weeks of this horrible crime, and people thought, my goodness, you know, well, it couldn't have been in production before this happened. And also, Arvo Garland did his thing before, so there was no real crossover, pure coincidence because of the mood of the country, I guess. But so Joe was, it also figured into the trial of Arvo Garland because the judge said that was hearing the case demanded that all the lawyers on both sides see the movie, but that they see no jurors who had seen the movie. Mm. Now, another, you know, and that's a crime of, you know, his daughter because he disagrees with her, you know, that it's really hard for me to fathom. But he actually received a lot of fan mail during the trial. And similarly, when Peter Boyle went to see a screening of Joe, he was greatly disheartened. When at the end, the final scene, he helps a friend supposedly come free his daughter from a commune, and he opens fire, Joe opens fire, and it's a bloody massacre. Well, as Peter Boyle was watching this, he heard people cheering that, the violence, and he was greatly upset by that too. And so this was, you know, the whole coincidence and everything was was very much in the news around the country back then as well. Now, a lot of those things like this, you know, it involved, you know, ordinary people's lives being shattered by something, you know, just out of the blue, and then these are people you never would have heard of all of a sudden become synonymous with this horrible event. But then there are other people in the book, of course, who are killers killing killers, who have chosen a life of crime, who, you know, like the Purple Gang in Detroit, when they had a gift, which, well, it's been said that Prohibition was the biggest gift the government ever gave to organized crime. They took away something that people wanted. The criminals decided to provide it. Michigan's gangs got that gift 18 months early. For some reason, Michigan had passed Prohibition 18 months before the rest of the government, the country. That combined with the fact that they were a narrow river across from Canada, where you could get booze, there were a lot of distilleries. You still see the Canadian Club sign over there and such. They were able to take boats out in the middle of the night with, you know, boats with no lights. A lot of freelancers worked for the mob, going back and forth every night, going out, get crates and crates of booze, coming back, making some pretty good money. And in the winter, they had to drive across the ice. Now, that was a little bit treacherous because, of course, you have to, you know, if you're familiar with ice crossings, you know, you have to kind of mark the thick spots. you have to mark the spots that are strong enough to go over, so, but you'll notice this is a good route, you'll put a little chunk of evergreen tree there, the snow there, and it'll be your marker. Of course, you're working with some nasty, or against some nasty people who are working for other gangs and who are rivals and such, and so they're moving your markers. So there's said to be some, you know, probably a few old cars with crates of whiskey and mobster skeletons in the Detroit River. Now, we, the Cripple Gang also stood up to Al Capone, who had said, "You guys got a great thing going, I'll run it for you, and you can work for me." And they said, "Buzz off, you know, we got this, you go back to where you're from and we'll sell to you." So, you know, they stood up to the most famous gangster of the era, but they worked well with them, and it was a lucrative thing for both ends. They would take, you know, truckloads of Canadian whiskey, and other booze would be going down Michigan Avenue, just day after day after day from Detroit to Chicago. Yeah. Well, in western Michigan, where it gets, you know, a little bit more, less popular, all of a sudden, Bugs Moran, who is a rival of Al Capone, decided to start hijacking some of those trucks. So he's taking them and he's selling them to his clients. And Capone, of course, has to do something about this. And so that was what led to the St. Valentine's Day Massacre, which was Capone, nobody knows who pulled the trigger. We still don't know that, we never will. Probably, but against Moran's gang in the garage in Chicago. The Purple Gang had a stake in that, obviously, and they're also believed to have, widely believed to have taken part in it, and some of them were even noticed by, like, landladies who had rented rooms to them across the road from where this occurred, and so they're rolling it. They're not believed to have been the trigger men, you know, none of the Purple Gang, but they are believed to have played lookout functions during this whole thing. But that, of course, I mentioned trends prior to that. Of course, that trend of the rum, or the whiskey running mobster was provided by a law that was passed, prohibition, and so that kind of happened that way. Prior to that, late 1800s, early 1900s, a trend in murder was poisoning, and that was often the weapon of choice of women. Women were almost exclusively the caretakers and the cooks and stuff back then, so they could slip it into the food of somebody if they, you know, wanted to. And the interesting thing, that the most widely used poison at the time was arsenic. Now, that was a household item that was used to kill rats. It was about 5 cents a little bag of it or something, you know, and it was said to not taste, you know, add much taste to the food, and so people would eat something, they would develop flu-like symptoms, and it would be fatal. And they believe that a lot of flu deaths back in a time when flu could kill, and did fairly often, they believe there were probably quite a few deaths that were attributed to flu that might have been murders with arsenic. But one of the most prolific poisoners was in northern Michigan. And she didn't really, she didn't go the arsenic way. She used strychnine. Now, strychnine was also a household item, often used to kill rats and mice, but it was, they both be gruesome deaths, but this one would contract people's muscles either forward or backwards in such a way that eventually they could not breathe and they died of asphyxiation. It was painful, it was awful. I guess it was a little quicker, that was one better thing about it than arsenic. But Mary McKnight began her poisoning career, as that we know of, in Alpena in the late 1800s. And it was a husband of hers. And she collected insurance, and I think it was a couple thousand dollars, which would have been close to $50,000 in today's, or $100,000. I've got it in the book, but I won't bother you to look up. I'll have to put it on my notes for next time. No, but it was in the hundreds of thousands. So once she had finally got to two husbands and gotten enough, you know, it was like, so she had definitely had a motive to do those two. But she's said to have killed 12 people at least, and perhaps as many as 18. 12 of, and they were almost all relatives. There are a lot of people. Are you plotting now? They were, so her trail of murder went from Alpena down to Saginaw, up to Grayling, and then over to Fife Lake, which is southeast of Traverse City. And finally, Fife Lake, I think she might have overshot. She killed a young family of three Murphys. Her brother, the husband was her brother. And within just a few days. And they all had this kind of grueling death. And finally, the sheriff and the coroner said, it doesn't seem right. You know, something's not right here. So they dug up the bodies a few weeks after the whole thing, and they sent stomach samples down to Traverse City, down to Ann Arbor, to be checked out, and they were, they found strychnine in the stomachs. And so she was convicted, and she was sent to Detroit House of Corrections. But the way, it's astonishing that she got away with this. Her death toll was even greater than John Norman Collins, who, but while these were happening, nobody knew there was a serial killer on the list. People were dying of what appeared to be a horrible illness, but word wasn't spreading very well. I mean, it was, you know, that of course they didn't have their smartphones. But I mean, you know, it was spread out, and it was, Northern Michigan, it was post-lumber boom, and it was a lot of people trying to eke out a very, very hard life of farming up in that area. Well, she ended up confessing, and I've got a little, just a window into Mary. It's a kind of a fascinating verbatim couple of paragraphs, and I've got more in here too, but I'll read you just a couple paragraphs of her confession. I think I lost my bookmark that was in here, but I will get it in just a second. Yeah, here it is. So Mary was telling to people to whom she was confessing. The baby woke up. Oh, I mentioned that it was a family. Yeah, the mother, father, and the baby. The baby woke up and cried while its mother was gone, and I mixed up a little strychnine in a glass with some water and gave a spoonful to the baby. I didn't mean to harm the little thing at all. I confessed all to the Lord this afternoon, and I feel that He has forgiven me. When Gertrude came home and found the baby dead, she got awfully nervous. She came to me and said, "Mary, can't you give me something to quiet me? Something that you take yourself?" I said that I wouldn't. I really didn't think that it would hurt her if I gave her one of the capsules. She had spasms right after that, and I suppose that it was the strychnine that killed her. I really didn't mean to hurt her. So that was, you know, kind of the innocence or the ignorance, I don't know, but nobody knew why, you know, beyond her husband, why was she doing this? Why, you know, what was her motive? Well, the thing that has kind of gone down in legend, and the one that, you know, may actually be true, was just a remark that one of her sisters made when somebody's in my age. One of her sisters apparently had escaped her wrath, said, why is she doing this? And she says, Mary just likes funerals. And I mean, it's not entirely, you know, unfathomable when you think that, you know, in the sparsely populated north at that time and place, there probably wasn't a lot going on. You didn't see people very often. So how do I get the family together? I mean, I suppose she could have tried to be a matchmaker and encourage weddings, but she went this route. But anyway, so that's a case that just fascinates a lot of people. Now, prior to that, as I was saying, the lumber boom was going through there, and then it moved up to the UP for the most part. And, so right at a similar time, there was a guy by the name of Daniel Dunn up in Sini, which is, if you're familiar with the UP, there's not much there. There's not much going on there. You know, it's Four Corners of the Sini Wildlife Refuge right there. And there is, a few buildings, a little restaurant, I think. But it was quite the boom town in Sini back in the late 1800s. And this one, I'm going to read something that illustrates one of the bad guys from that era, who sounds like somebody you might have found, you know, in a Western, somebody from Deadwood, South Dakota or something. But some of these lumber towns were a lot like, you know, the Wild West. So this is about Daniel Dunn, and I'm going to read a short chapter about him, and then I'm going to take questions, if that would be okay with everyone. And so I'm going to, this is called Dunn Inn. It's the year 1880, the crime, murder, the motive, he killed my brother. Michigan had several tough but temporary lumbering towns as the white pine boom swept through the state and changed the landscape forever. Sini, in the center of the UP, was one of the roughest. It attracted hundreds of hard-drinking, fist-fighting lumbermen and tobacco-chewing saloon girls for the 15 or so years the trees lasted. But none of the cursing, brawling lumbermen could hold a kerosene lantern to Daniel Dunn, who owned one of the several saloons in town. Dunn actually started his notorious career in Roscommon to the north central lower peninsula. The allure of Sini's thirst must have called to him. But first, he needed money. Dunn hired a lumberman to burn down the saloon and brothel businesses he wanted to leave behind to move further north. $50 for the arsonist, the insurance for Dunn. Off to Sini he went, quickly establishing the saloon to compete with the 20 or so other taverns, plus three brothels already there. Unfinished business from Roscommon soon came calling. A druggist, who loaned Dunn money, made a long trip up north to collect. Well, says Dunn, he doesn't quite have the cash, but he's working on it. He does, however, know of an ore deposit in a nearby bog. But shh, please don't tell anyone. Promise not to tell anyone, and I'll show it to you, he confides. Out they went to the bog, and as the druggist was bending over to take a look at some of the valuable metal, Dunn shot him in the back of the head. A little while later, another old Roscommon friend came calling. It happened to be the chap who burned down the brothel as a favor for Mr. Dunn. He wasn't doing so well and decided that Dunn hadn't paid him quite enough. Let's just say he got to look at the ore deposits in the bog too. There were rumblings around town about Dunn and his disappearing friends from downstate. But the one who finally said something about it to his face was Steve Harcourt. He was one of the six Harcourt brothers, proprietors of a competing saloon/bordello. With no love for Daniel Dunn, Harcourt slipped into Dunn's business to talk trash and spit some accusations. Dunn quickly had enough and broke a whiskey bottle over Harcourt's head, then shot him twice. Harcourt died a few days later, and Daniel Dunn was arrested for manslaughter, but the judge dismissed the charges. Dunn had acted in self-defense, the judge said. Still, Dunn knew there were five more Harcourt brothers who would be seeking revenge. He thought if he could get to St. Ignace, he could get a court order to keep the brothers away. He took his wife along for the ride, and on the way they stopped at Trout Lake and got a room. He shouldn't have stopped. While looking out of his second floor digs, Dunn caught sight of brother Jim Harcourt. Dunn drew his pistol and sneaked down the stairs to take care of the threat, but Harcourt was ready for him and shot him four times. After serving 3 years in Marquette State Prison, Jim Harcourt returned to Sini, a hero. So that's, you know, kind of the vein in which the book is written, and I have lived in several spots of Michigan, Sault Ste. Marie, Detroit, Lansing, Traverse City, but I have to say I'm learning more and more as I'm touring about different parts of the state, and there will be subsequent editions of this, and I'm learning more about your beautiful part of the state, and was wondering if you know of any great stories that I should include in the future. So anyway, I'm ready to take questions if anybody has any. Yes, sir.
Why do people get so excited about family killings?
Why do people get so excited about family killings?
My father always believed that if I kill a 7-Eleven clerk, I should be prosecuted, but if I kill my brother and I wasn't right, somebody else in the family will kill me.
I don't know if the rest of you heard that, but, I guess I'll boil it down to the question, but yeah, why do people get such a kick out of the thought of killing family members? I guess that's an interesting point, and I've noticed that at other places that I've spoken to. I think we all probably have somebody in our family that, you know, rubs us the wrong way, not that deserves anything like that, but I'm sure nobody would ever do it. But I think there's just a fascination with murder in general, just the extremes of human behavior and stuff. I think there's just a, but yeah, there's something that I that's a very good question, and I'd love to get to the bottom of why that is, but what everybody kind of snickers or laughs when you say that Mary McKnight killed mostly family members. So, yes, ma'am.
I lived in St. Joe for a while, and just north of that was where Al Capone had his summer home.
Oh, okay.
In that area. And I don't know if you want to investigate that.
I
do. A girl I worked with, a woman I worked with many years ago, her family was involved with the Capones, it was the typical, I'm Italian, she was Italian family, and that's what drew us together, and it was the typical thing where they'd sit down to dinner, and everybody would sit down to dinner, the parents, you know, the women, the children, and then they'd all get up and leave, and all the men would sit and discuss whatever business they had to discuss, and you never said anything to anybody. And she was like 3 and 4 years old when she could remember a lot of things that went on.
That's fascinating.
Yeah, and of
course. Do you want to give her my business card?
Capone was dead, you know, was long dead before that. But the gangster thing was still going on back in the 70s
and 80s. Oh,
yeah.
You know, so.
Well, I have gangster stories in here from, including Jimmy Hoffa, but others later on. And I'm also researching some things about, you know, hideouts. And there's also supposedly a, I don't know, did anybody hear her comments? Did everybody hear her comments? Okay. I'm sorry, I'm trying to remember to repeat them. But there were, I stopped in Albion not too long ago, and there's a movie theater there that they say they have like four seats or something that's like in a little alcove right under the projection machine, which would have drowned out the sound, and that's where Capone's Men and Purple Gang members would meet to discuss their, you know, liquor business. And so it's still there. And Unfortunately, when I was in town, I went, you know, checking it out, and the theater was closed at the moment. But I'm going to try to get there while it's open and see if I can see it. So there are a lot of things like that. There's something in the thumb that I just heard a little bit about. There was supposedly a hideout for gangsters, and I think this was Purple Gang as well, in the thumb, where there might have been a little bit of a shootout at one time. This is something that somebody told me at an event that I went to, but I haven't gotten enough details to really nail it down. So if anybody knows anything about that, please let me know. Yes?
Isn't there an area up by Reed City, a small town up there where they came from Chicago?
Isn't there an area in Reed City where they came from Chicago?
It's a small town. I think it starts with a B. There was a lot of the crime scene from Chicago would go up there.
Okay.
And they even...
Reed City?
Yeah.
I hadn't heard that.
Yeah.
Now, I've heard that Capone had a place in the Leonoff Peninsula, the Pinky. And I've heard, you know... Well, I'm actually doing a Wisconsin book. We're doing a Great Lakes series of this type. Plus, I'm working on another edition of Michigan. But anyway, so yeah, I know Dillinger and his friends went up to northern Wisconsin and stuff. I mean, there's probably, it'd be fascinating to know. It's kind of hard to nail that kind of stuff down because they were hiding out. They didn't want, you know.
Well, it was a regular compound.
Oh, a compound in Reed City. Wow.
Well, not Reed City itself. It was in a
near
small
Reed City.
Town.
Yes. Okay.
That could be the same area between, because Reed City is not that far from Bering Springs or Benton Harbor, St. Joe, in that area along Michigan.
Reed City is far out. No, north of it. Isn't that the one that just north of that, Big Rapids? Reed City? But I mean, in general, yeah, I'm sure they spread out because they wanted to come up here into northern Michigan into spots that were you know, relatively quiet. And I see people are sitting up and getting
ready. No, we haven't been yet.
Oh, okay.
And I'm sorry, but I'd love to sit.
Okay. Well, yes, sir.
Well, I was just wondering, curious if you ever heard of the murder in the Doherty Hotel.
The Dory Hotel?
In Clare.
Dory.
Dory?
D-O-H-E-R-T-Y.
Clare, Michigan.
And it had to do with the lawyer that was a lawyer for the Purple Gang.
Wow. Yeah. No, this is how I get a lot of...
I got another one for you. Have you ever heard of the South End Gang right here in Bay City?
No.
Oh, boy.
I will... Definitely take a look into that. Were they pretty illustrious and great? Okay. What era are we talking about?
I'd want to say the 20s and 30s, maybe.
Okay.
And there's the building's still standing. It used to be a bank where they committed a couple murders.
Wow.
Right there on 30th and Broadway here in Bay City.
Okay.
We can be famous.
Excellent. I mean... that's something I have to try to be careful about. Yes, ma'am.
Have you ever looked into the Oakland County child killers?
Yes, she asked if I looked into the Oakland County child killer, and this, I do have a chapter in here about that. And what I look at most are like some of the theories of what's going on, and also the long-standing red herring that was out there about the murderer driving a blue gremlin. And I remember that too from the early, late 70s, early 80s. And I talked to a woman when I was speaking in Troy who said that her father was questioned several times and it had a rather negative impact on his life and his reputation that police talked to him several times simply because he drove a blue gremlin. Well, later on, it appeared that they said that was a false clue. That didn't, that's, you know. And so a lot of, they I've heard it said that the Oakland County authorities actually questioned every single person in Oakland County who owned a blue gremlin. But later on, I tend to think that, and there's a very interesting theory about the guy who was the son of a GM executive and who ended up killing himself and might have been the perpetrator of this. But there's also been talk as to whether it had something to do with Fox Island in Lake Michigan, one of the Fox Islands that was owned by a multimillionaire, and they would take underprivileged kids to this island, and no parents there, and it was supposed to be a great opportunity for kids, and they were actually making child pornography. And this was around that era, and as soon as the heat was on with this millionaire, he fled to the Netherlands and lived until the 90s, when he died. But I don't know if any of that is connected, but I do address some of that in here and just give the, you know, what's out there as far as, you know, whether there's it connects all the dots, I don't know. But they think that maybe that had something to do with the Oakland County child killings.
Well, several years ago, I read where the police had a long-standing suspect, but they didn't have enough evidence. And then this suspect died, and they were trying to get some kind of permission to do DNA. And I never heard anything more about it.
Oh, well, that might be, was the death a suicide?
I don't know. I don't think it said anything. Oh,
okay.
But I don't remember.
If that was the case, I mean, you know, it was... Yeah, came from a powerful family, and that might have been. I don't want to speculate. All I know is that, you know, there are a lot of people who believe that it could have been this son of a GM executive who killed himself, but had also had a history of child molestation and stuff. So.
Mm-hmm. That's a little off the track. There was a murder in 1968, Goodhart, Michigan.
Yes. I have a chapter in here on that.
Yeah.
Yeah, you mentioned the Goodhart murder, and that is a perplexing, horrible case where a whole family was shot to death, and they weren't found for quite some time. It was kind of a secluded Lake Michigan cabin that they had, and finally somebody thought that maybe there was a dead animal somewhere. They went over there, and it was the whole family had been killed, and they're. It might have had something to do with shady dealings from the father, who was in advertising down in Lathrop Village where they lived. But then there was the main suspect for a long time was a guy who had worked with Mr. Robeson, the father, and he also committed suicide. But his suicide note says, "I've done a lot of bad things or something like that, but I am not a killer." So I don't, you know, that's one that will probably never be solved, but it's, one of those that once you hear about it, it kind of sticks with you. Yes, ma'am.
Two questions. On the motive, not keeping up for Stephen Gifford Simmons, what does that mean?
Oh, not keeping up. She's asking what the Stephen Gifford Simmons not keeping up was the motive, as I had the page up there. It had been said that he had one of the stories that went around was that he was drinking whiskey or drinking from a liquor jug, whatever, maybe hard cider or something, and she wasn't. He wanted her to drink, and she wasn't keeping up, and so they said he hit her once, and that was the fatal blow. But in reality, she was a strong pioneer woman from other things that I've read, and they would fight, and she usually held her own, but he killed her.
Married McKnight?
Yes.
So the baby died, the mother died, then the dad came home, then what?
Oh, the dad, he also, she gave him some. He was grieving, and she gave him the, confession, but yeah, she got the mother. I've seen the grave where the family is buried, and sadly the baby daughter is buried with the mother. She's not identified on the gravestone, but she's
What did you say happened to her then? There's Mary?
Mary McKnight. She served, and I think it was 18 years, but she went to Detroit House of Corrections, which is between Northville and Plymouth down near Detroit, was. And it was open until not that long ago. I think it became a men's prison. It was a women's prison, became a men's prison, you know, but I think it's now, I do believe it's now closed.
Was she released then, or did she die in prison?
Oh, I believe she was released. She was paroled. Well, Arnold Garland, who killed his daughter and the other, he ended up actually serving 10 years. And then went back down to Tennessee where he was from and died, you know, peaceful. Death, I guess. Yes, could we, one more, is that?
Did you ever get any clues to where Jimmy Hoffa was there?
No more than anybody else. I talked about the fact that there's always, you know, something comes up and they dig up a field or a garage or whatever, but yeah.
I got an idea about that.
You know, he's got an idea about Hoffa?
I swear to God, this is my own theory.
Okay.
When I was a kid, I was driving down the middle grounds. There used to be a house down there where it's,
Middle grounds?
Middle grounds in Bay City. It's down by the Sands Bar.
Okay.
And I was driving down there and I saw this little house. And I'm just looking, I'm going, all these cars had New York plates, Cadillacs, you know. I'm going, what the hell's going on with this? So I'm thinking, well, I know where they buried them. They buried them in the freaking, they buried them in the waste dump that's no longer in use. And who's going to dig that up now? All that toxic stuff in there?
Hey,
nobody's going to be looking for Jimmy in there.
Yeah, you could be right. Or, any other Sopranos fans here? I mean, they were always hanging out at that meat market. And with one of their victims, one of their associates that they had to deal with, they ended up putting him through the sausage.
Oh,
who knows? But that's fiction. That's fiction, although I don't know if it's based on reality or not. I thank you so much, Art. I thank you very much. I have books for sale here, and I can answer other questions. The book is $14.95, and I accept cash and cards. Checks I haven't done so far, but I prefer cash and credit. Thank you very much.